Can I welcome everyone to the Justice Committee Subcommittee on Policing, the ninth, it's our ninth meeting in 2015. Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices completely as they interfere with broadcasting, even when they're switched to silent. No apologies received. I welcome Roderick Campbell to the meeting. Decision on taking business in private, item one. Do you agree to take item three, consideration of our work programme in private? Thank you very much. Item two, stop and search. This is the main item on today's agenda and evidence session on stop and search. Now, welcome to the meeting, John Scott, QC, Chair of the Advisory Group on Stop and Search. As members are aware, the Advisory Group made recommendations to the Cabinet Secretary of Justice on the policy and practice of stop and search in late August, and many of these recommendations have already been taken forward through amendments to the Criminal Justice Bill, which we had the delight of dealing with early in the week for a very prolonged session. On behalf of the subcommittee, I'd like to thank John Scott and the advisory group for their significant work in this area, which we've had an interest in for some months. It's right that we spend some time today exploring the report in more detail, and I'll go straight to questions from members, if that's okay with you, Mr. Scott.
Of course, yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Right, who wants to kick off? Margaret, then John, then... Oh, they're keen. Margaret, John, Elaine, then Alison. Right, in that order, and then Kevin.
Good afternoon. You'll be aware, obviously, of the problems associated with data collection, the reliability, availability, and hence the recommendation five. I wonder if you could give a little bit more detail on the regular reports to SPA, the nature, frequency, level, etc.
So far as that's concerned, I think the SPA already had in mind that they would be looking for this data, and Police Scotland already had in mind that it would be provided. So the recommendation was to follow up on something that was already the part of the plan. So far as the frequency of the reports, I can't actually now remember what the frequency was to be, but I think it was no less than about four times a year. I think we were certainly getting data on a monthly basis during the short time of the review, and in particular because there had been so many significant changes earlier on in the year, the data was being monitored to make sure that what had been the intention was in fact being implemented, and we were able to see the shift from non-statutory to statutory, and also to see the success rate improving in relation to statutory.
So there's been a report. It's such an important part, data. We can't monitor, you can't evaluate how successful, how well a policy is working or a certain initiative without that. And given that there was such a divergence in the information coming forward, A, about the status of the data, if it was accurate, B, if there had been any reason not to provide it, all of these things hitting at the very centre of the accountability and transparency that public have a right to expect in this issue.
Absolutely, I couldn't agree with you more. And part of what we were hoping is that the data would be available for consideration by, for example, academics like Dr. Kath Murray, who I think is here in the public gallery for this session, to make sure that there's additional checks on what is being represented as contained in the data.
So have we any idea, has a report gone already? Is there a first date for when the next report is due with this?
I'm afraid I'm not sure about that. When we finished our work, the plan then was that we would retain an involvement, but it would kick in again after the various consultations that had been recommended and accepted. And so the advisory group then would become involved in looking at the code of practice once we had the detailed responses to the consultation, and also on the alcohol and young people side of it. So I've had one meeting with at Police Scotland so far, and I've got another meeting next Friday. So it's something that will stay very firmly on the agenda. But I'm afraid I'm not sure. I had to get back to dealing with some other things after the end of August. So I'm sorry I can't answer that question.
Well,
at the moment.
Hopefully the fact it's been raised today will put it back firmly on the agenda too.
Of course,
thank you very much, Margaret. I've got John followed by Alison, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Mr. Scott. And can I thank the advisory group for all their work, and you for the report? It's I found it very refreshing. We know why we're here, and I'm keen perhaps we look forward a bit. There was a line right at the opening of your report, talking, listening is an essential part of good policing. Is that something that's recognised by the Scottish Police Service at the moment?
I'm not sure. I think that this has been an extended period of transition. I think there's a good number of police officers who've always known that, who've never forgotten it. I think, however, that there's perhaps been a newer generation of officers for whom that's not been made quite as clear, and that things like targets, unfortunately, have skewed things away from the Peelian principles, the approach that the police are the public are the police, and that there's nothing to stop police officers talking to people, regardless of what we said, regardless of what the practice was before, but things had become target-driven and therefore moved into stop and search much more quickly in situations where our view was the police could simply have spoken to people and that would have resolved any suspicions, concerns that they had, and would have avoided some of the damage to public confidence that has resulted from the excessive use and disproportionate use of the tactic of consensual or non-statutory.
Do you think police officers who perhaps are fairly junior in service and have not known too much of a different regime, will they need to be empowered to exercise their power of discretion, which is the most important power, arguably, they have?
That's my sense, yes, from speaking to some officers. One thing that struck me very strongly was that the officers we met, even those who very firmly believed that they should be allowed to continue using non-statutory stop and search, seemed genuine in thinking that they needed that in order to be able to do their job properly. Now, we disagreed that they needed that facility, that tactic, in order to be able to do their jobs properly. But for those officers who've become convinced of that, there's clearly going to be a transition, which is one of the reasons that we talked about making sure that the implementation stage is as detailed, as thorough, and takes a bit of time to get those officers round to the point where some of their more senior colleagues perhaps still remember about individual discretion, you're answering for your own actions, being told that there's targets isn't an answer if you have to go to court and explain why you did a particular thing, but also that you have extensive powers and you don't need to fall back on something that couldn't be properly explained, couldn't be properly defined, couldn't be properly trained on. You can still do the job properly, and that there's perfectly acceptable ways of doing it within a proper framework. So I think that there will be a cultural shift there, there's training implications, and that there are some officers that will need that support.
Your appointment was warmly welcome for a number of reasons, not least your background with human rights. What role do Police Scotland play in human rights in Scotland?
That's been an interesting subject for me for quite a while. Prior to Police Scotland, there was contact between various voluntary organisations I've been involved with through human rights and some of the legacy forces. So Lothian and Borders in particular, there was fairly regular contact. The Inspectorate of Constabulary, there was fairly regular contact. I was asked to contribute to a thematic inspection of firearms. Strathclyde Police used to send us a Christmas card when we had the Scottish Human Rights Centre, which was just round the corner from Pitt Street Police Headquarters, and we were in Holland Street. So human rights had always featured to an extent.
There was a message in there. Was it on the Christmas card?
Well, it became slightly embarrassing when we were having meetings with other human rights organisations from other countries and they were explaining their experiences with police forces and we had to confess that we got a Christmas card from ours. So it's always been part of it. It's very important now, and I welcome the fact that human rights is specifically mentioned in the oath that officers take, and I understand that that you had a part to play in that. So that's been very important. And there are very good officers within Police Scotland who I see as being personally committed to the idea of an ethical approach and to human rights. And some of them will remain in the organisation and be able to make sure that human rights and an ethical approach remain as an important part of how things are dealt with. Perhaps even, you know, recognising it more than has been the case in some occasions.
indeed the police are at the front line of defending human rights.
Well, that's right. Again, in recent years, I've heard the now Lord Advocate, although I think it was the Solicitor General at the time, saying that Crown Office is a frontline human rights organisation and the police service is a frontline human rights organisation as well. And that tying that in with the oath, that's a very good way, I think, of officers to see it and also to embrace the idea of human rights. It offers them some protections, but it offers the public some protections, and it allows for frameworks to be put in place. It requires frameworks to be put in place and for scrutiny, which is something that if officers are doing the job well, they should welcome. And indeed, that was my experience, that there were officers who were saying, we want scrutiny because we have considerable powers and we want to have to answer to someone for them.
Okay, and that positive note, I'll thank you again. Thank you.
Do you mind if I take Alison next? We seem to have got the names muddled up. Alison, then Elaine, then Kevin. Alison, please.
Okay, thank you very much, convener. And thank you to Mr. Scott for your very rigorous report. I think it's certainly helped immensely in this area. And I think I was particularly welcome the fact that you put it in context and that you say in your introduction that operational matters must be for the police to decide, but defining the limits of police power is not an operational matter. It's a matter of public policy for the Parliament. And I think that's a very important thing for us to remember. You must be in quite a unique position. You write a report and within a month, its recommendations are transposed into legislation. That's really quite exceptional. Quite often reports sit for a long time on the shelf. One thing, though, that the government has done is gone a step further than what you've recommended, and that is in relation to the issue of stop and search and alcohol possession. And I wonder whether you would like to comment on whether or not you agree with the Scottish Children and Young People's Commissioner, who felt that that was premature to take that step in the legislation.
Dealing first with the uniqueness of the response, I think there were a number of aspects of the review that were unique. I was entertained by the fact that the Scotsman at one stage described their report as the long-awaited report, and I wondered, given that from start to finish it was 5 months, how it would be possible to meet those sort of expectations. So far as the alcohol and the power of search, in particular for young people, is concerned, my understanding of that, and I've remained in contact with officials, I've not simply finished off the report and then put it aside myself, albeit I did have to take the family to Centre Parks to make up for an absentee period in August. As I understand it, the provision that's been put in place is only intended to be used if, in fact, the consultation responses once considered lead to the view that such a power should be introduced. It was a very difficult area for us. At times it seemed straightforward, but with about a month to go, some of the complications then started becoming apparent. And I should say, in fairness to Police Scotland and those within the policing community, that some of the complications and whether it was necessary at all were points that were made to me by people from within the policing community. But the point was also forcefully made by those with an interest in children's rights. And I agree with the sentiments expressed by the Commissioner. I couldn't myself reach a firm conclusion on it. It did seem to be a significant part of the whole area of stop and search. There are clearly issues about vulnerable young people, and therefore, I think it wasn't an area that we felt we could simply say, well, don't bother with it at all. What I think, however, is important, and it's why we made the recommendation in the terms that we did, is that there be a full and meaningful consultation where all of these issues can be canvassed, and in a situation where we couldn't make up our minds, that more people get an opportunity to have a say on it, in particular people from children and young persons groups and those involved with them, so that we can explore all of the issues and then make a decision. A decision can ultimately be made, bearing in mind that there will probably be a price to pay for that decision. So if the decision was that there should be such a power introduced, then there may be implications for confidence of young people in policing, depending on how that's handled, and that might be an area where the code of practice helps. If, however, the decision was that there shouldn't be such a power introduced, then care would need to be taken to make sure that the police still felt that they were able to deal with youngsters who are putting themselves in vulnerable positions, although there are child protection powers available that might come into play there. In 5 months, although we did a lot, I think so far as that area was concerned, we were simply able to identify that it was more complicated than would allow for easy recommendations within that period. And the other thing, of course, is we had the call for evidence, but it was over the period of the summer. Now, I entirely understand and agree with why we had the short timescale that we did for producing our report, but what it meant was it was a period when lots of groups weren't able to get together and put in a response even to the call for evidence. So I've gone out to speak to some people in those groups, and I know that they want to contribute to the consultation so that all of the issues can be properly canvassed and that the pros and cons examined before ultimately a decision is made, taking into account a wider range of evidence than we were able to assemble.
If I might pursue that just a bit further. Thank you very much for your answer there. Am I right in my reading of the report that you said the majority of the group felt that there wasn't a gap?
Yes, no significant gaps.
No significant gap in relation to it. We know that it was difficult at first because the figures were all amalgamated, but since June, I think the figures have been disaggregated, and we can look at the pattern, and we know that in June and July this year, alcohol detections from seizures, which is a power that the police already have to hand, accounted for 91%. Of the detections. Alcohol detections from non-statutory stop and search was only 306 searches, which is 6%.
Yes.
So it's actually a very small amount. And if the remaining 3% was found, obviously, through statutory stop and search. So we're talking about a very small area. Is there a danger that we do something disproportionate with this?
That is clearly a risk, and it's one of the things that would have to be taken into account when all of the evidence is in. I suspect that there will be evidence from the Children's Commissioner and others saying that, given that that's a measure of the one measure of the problem, that putting legislation into place for that would be disproportionate. As I say, it's part of what we weren't eventually able to answer, but the question of proportionality is a key aspect of it, and it's one of the ways in which human rights challenges can come into play. So the absence of a framework, which was a clear problem with non-statutory stop and search, but then whether it's used proportionately is another aspect. And so that's something that a careful eye will have to be kept on. And to come back to the point about data, it will be important to monitor the data to make sure that there's no unseen or unintended aspects of disproportionality in the use of statutory powers.
You mentioned the ECHR. I mean, given that voluntary stop and search foundered because of its lack of legitimacy and the challenges to its lawfulness and compatibility with ECHR, would you like to comment on the legitimacy of the proposal to give police stop and search powers over something that's not in itself criminal?
That, again, was one of the issues, and I think it's a point that John Carnahan, one of the founding co-directors of the Violence Reduction Unit, made as well. The whole question of alcohol and how we teach children and young people about it becomes extremely complicated, and there's always risks of mixed messages there. I think if the focus comes from the point of view of keeping young people safe and making sure that they are not criminalised, then that's a safer approach that will hopefully result in identifying the right answer. But that is one of the many complicating factors about it.
I certainly think that an approach that looked at keeping young people out of the justice system and therefore recognised that stopping children getting access to alcohol in the first place was where the focus should be, rather than risking drawing them into the criminal justice system, because we're not clear what we would do with those powers of search, or indeed just damaging that relationship between the police and the communities.
Well, that was when Westminster Parliament in 1997 looked at the question of seizure and search. That was one of the things that that troubled them, and that's why there was no specific power of search of young people for alcohol given at that point. Mm-hmm. I think we have scope. I'm not convinced that they had the most detailed debate or discussion about it. I think that the consultation that is going to happen allows for far greater consideration of the various issues involved, but there isn't, I think, an easy answer or an answer that covers absolutely every aspect, I'm afraid.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
But it would be the case, and I hear you about there might be child protection issues involved, particularly in this stop and search for alcohol, that in those circumstances, they might, to take up what my colleague said, there might then be referrals to a children's panel rather than going into the criminal justice system. Is that not the case?
It's possible, yes. I mean, there's separate procedures for child protection. Yeah. There's things that may go to the children's panel. But the children's groups are anxious that there be no unintended drift into the youth or the criminal justice system.
Absolutely. But I thought it was important to put that measure in. I mean, you could have a 9 or 10-year-old that might be carrying alcohol because it's been placed on them, and there'd be a huge issue there about child protection issues, which would be an issue about the whole family situation and so on.
Yes.
Elaine, followed by Kevin.
Thanks very much, Convener. You're probably aware that the Scottish Police Federation have produced a little publication in favour of stop search powers. I just wondered what sort of conversations your group had with the SPF and ASPS in terms of their approach and how, as they will be supporting their members, if things change, how they will support their members in terms of a change of culture within the police.
Of course. I think we did mention the Police Federation document in our report, although they didn't give separate specific evidence to us. I think that document was prepared for the Parliament. I had a meeting with an official from the Scottish Police Federation, which is mentioned in the report, and also that was Callum Steele and Niven Rennie from ASPS. They both made the position of their organisations and their members clear, although recognising in particular with ASPS, that there were a range of views. It wasn't as simple as there's a single superintendent's view on the matter. I think it's perhaps safer to say that the Federation was in a stronger position to say that there is a Federation view. My view is that in the new landscape without non-statutory stop and search, the Federation and ASPS will be able to do the same good job for their members, part of which will be helping to make sure that their members understand that they're not prevented from carrying out any necessary police duties at all by the change in the landscape. They do not, in fact, have less powers, because what we were talking about before wasn't a power. Mm. Actually, a lot of police officers who spoke to me informally said that they didn't like non-statutory at all. We had a submission from someone who said that they were a serving police officer, and he referred back to the targets, obviously, that changed earlier on this year, but he was very uncomfortable but felt he was under pressure to do it, and that was echoed by a number of other officers, where there were some also who said that they'd never used the power and never missed it. They never noticed a point where they felt they weren't able to do something. And we don't think that there should be any situations where there are officers frozen in inaction because they think, well, I'm now not sure what I can do because I don't have non-statutory stop and search. Having reasonable grounds to suspect that the person's in possession of something isn't an enormous or insuperable burden for the officer to satisfy himself or herself of before searching. Statutory search is much more likely to produce an item. Something's more likely to be found because the officer has identified for themselves that there's a basis for doing it, whereas non-statutory arguably was a very, very poor use of police time, given the small return, the small success rate in finding anything. And that, coupled with the damage that it did to public confidence, along with a number of other issues, we were, I think, more troubled by the legitimacy of it than by the lawfulness, but there were clearly issues over all of that, means that it had to go. But what an offer I made to the Federation and to ASPS and to Police Scotland is that I will continue to meet with them, whether it's small meetings, private meetings, big meetings, public meetings, to go along to their annual conferences. I've already, I think, been lined up for the ASP's annual conference in May to go along and explain our thinking, but partly to explain to officers at all levels that this isn't about hobbling them in any way, and we don't think that that's a necessary consequence of it, but it's about regaining the confidence in the statutory powers, which a lot of officers and prosecutors I've spoken to were surprised that there had been such a shift, such an emphasis away from that, when that had been the more successful approach and that had been the traditional approach to the whole question of stop and search. But I am sure that the Federation and ASPS will be able to do as good a job in trying to persuade their members of the case for the new landscape as they did in trying to persuade others of the case against it.
You know, if it's handled properly and the appropriate information given to officers and taking SPF and ASPS on board with us, that you don't think there'll be any significant difficulties in implementing this sort of change in policy?
No, I don't. And that was a very important part of it. And trying to make sure that the report was set in that sort of context, it was not designed to be a report that was solely critical of Police Scotland or of particular practices. It was trying to put everything in a context where stop and search is only a very small part of police activity, but was given a significant amount of attention because it was being used disproportionately. So I wanted to make sure that the whole policing community and Police Scotland and the members' organisations felt that they will be able to work with the new landscape. They won't be stopped from doing the things that they feel that they need to do. And in fact, it will offer them some protection, some safeguards that are missing in a situation where they are told to do something, there are targets to behave in a particular way, and they lose the individual discretion, or they lose their sense of the individual discretion and answering for what they did to the courts, for example, rather than simply answering to their sergeant at the end of the shift.
Thank you. Kevin, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon. Your recommendation 10 said that discussion should take place between Police Scotland and other partners on the most appropriate methods of dealing with children and vulnerable adults who come to notice for protection and welfare reasons during stop and search situations. Could you expand on your thinking of that recommendation, please, Mr. Scott?
Of course, Mr. Stewart, yes. While we were starting off our work, one of the areas that we identified as a useful way into the whole subject was, are there in fact any gaps that the use of non-statutory stop and search has masked? And alcohol was mentioned first, second and last, but child and adult protection issues were also mentioned as something that the police used non-statutory stop and search to deal with. And that puzzled us. We had Anne Houston on the group, and Anne's obviously been heavily involved in child protection issues, but also made contact with the adult protection committees for us as well. And none of the conveners of the child and adult protection groups recognised the use of non-statutory stop and search as a police tool in the area of adult and child protection. A number of issues there, but it was put forward to us as one possible gap. If you took away non-statutory, then what were the police going to do when confronted with certain adult and child protection issues? But looking at it from a slightly different angle, issues of consent then were perhaps even more troubling. When you're talking about children, there was general recognition that the consent that was sought and apparently obtained was not fully informed consent, not least because of the power imbalance. So that would also apply to some of the adult protection issues we were talking about with vulnerable people in times of distress who were therefore not in the best position to be able to understand and to give informed consent to a search. It just seemed absolutely the wrong way into a situation where the use of what's effectively an enforcement power or tactic could exacerbate some of the factors creating the vulnerability of the individual concerned. So, but in speaking to Anne Houston and speaking to people from the Child and Adult Protection Committees, also speaking to Colin Mackay at the Mental Welfare Commission, it seemed that although everyone agreed that non-statutory stop and search was really the wrong way to think about getting into it, clearly some officers thought that they had to. There are some powers there, I think, in particular, responsibilities given to the local authority, but also to some partners of the local authority. However, it's an area where the legislation, there's a number of different bits of legislation, it's all maybe not quite as clearly translated for individual officers about how they approach questions of protection. But what we were saying was, it shouldn't, whatever it is, it shouldn't be non-statutory stop and search. There are responsibilities and there are powers in place, but what seemed to us missing was a translation of the high level, the statutory powers, down to officers who thought that they had to use non-statutory stop and search as a way into it, when that was neither appropriate nor justified. So it was really just to make sure that the dialogue that we thought maybe was necessary came out of this process, and that non-statutory stop and search was removed as one means of trying to engage with children and young people in vulnerable positions.
We have some despicable people out there who are involved in criminal activity who wouldn't give second thought to using children or vulnerable adults to carry out business for them. Mr. Finney talked earlier about an officer's discretion, and obviously there are occasions where officers probably have to use their discretion a fair amount in terms of dealing with some of these kind of situations. Do you think that the removal of non-statutory stop and search may actually, in these occasions, have a real difficulty in terms of the officer deciding how they carry out the business to deal with a possible safety issue for these children and vulnerable adults?
No, it shouldn't. Part of the transition away from non-statutory may be in making sure that officers understand that they have got means of dealing with these situations other than by use of non-statutory. But
could you give us examples of the other means that they could use, the other means at their disposal that they could to deal with the situation?
Statutory stop and search of children is still possible. If officers have reasonable grounds to suspect that they're in possession of drugs or knives or the like, then they can stop and search them. And that's not changed at all. We make no recommendation about that. If it was thought that children were being used in that way, then the police and the child was in possession of something, the police can search them. And then, no doubt, the primary investigation is in relation to the adult involved, but child protection referrals could be made. It may be that the children's panel would become involved too, but the use of non-statutory stop and search isn't an essential part of that. So child protection referral is one method of dealing with it. Involvement of the children's panel is another. Statutory stop and search is still possible if there are reasonable grounds to suspect possession of these items. So it's not something that I see the police as being prevented from dealing with at all.
And in the case of vulnerable adults?
In the case of vulnerable adults, there are adult protection referrals possible, but I struggle with the idea that an appropriate method of... An example that was given to us was, say, a family phoned the police. They say that the brother has had mental health issues recently. He had a quantity of sleeping pills which aren't in the house anymore, he's not in the house anymore, and they think he's gone to a local spot known for suicides. And if the police went along to the place and they found the person, could they not use non-statutory or consensual stop and search in that situation? Now, the first thing that struck me was, in that situation with that vulnerable individual, firstly, they can't... It cannot be said with any certainty that they would be in the state of mind where they could give informed consent to a search. So the police asking for it would really be meaningless. They would not be able to satisfy themselves or anyone else that the individual was in a position to consent. Secondly, however, with an individual in that situation, there are a number of things that could happen which could exacerbate what occurs. And I would have thought that the use of an enforcement tactic is one of those. There's been, I think, a pilot in Glasgow of a mental health triage approach where a mental health nurse goes out with police officers to deal with situations involving vulnerable adults who may be vulnerable because of the consumption of excessive consumption of drink or drugs, which they've taken voluntarily. But you then use the mental health nurse as your way into it rather than two uniformed officers saying, we want to search you. If the person in a situation like that had said, I don't agree to be searched, then what could the police do? If the individual said that they did agree to be searched and they found the tablets, what could they do? It would simply put them in a position where they had to consider the adult protection referral mechanisms. One of the problems, I think, has been the fact that police in those sort of situations very often take the person to the hospital. The hospital will deal with them, say that they're drunk, and then discharge them. The police, understandably anxious not to simply let the person go out and do the same thing again, may end up arresting them. But the problem there is that the hospital's not dealing with matters properly or may not be dealing with matters properly, and it then simply becomes part of the skip of activities that the police end up having to deal with. But the answer isn't non-statutory stop and search.
Okay. I was just thinking, which was an excellent example, but I was just thinking, they're forewarned there. What if it was an immediate situation that the police were placed in where they became aware themselves that someone was going to self-harm? Would that not be grounds for letting them intervene just at that moment? I appreciate all about the autonomy of the person and so on. I mean, it's a very difficult area to know when they should intervene, and it'd be right to do so and wrong to do so. I'm just wondering what, if there's any room at all for that.
Well, my understanding is that in relation to adult protection powers, the police could act with the necessary degree of urgency. So if they were presented with a situation, that's what they thought was happening, then using adult protection powers, not using non-statute stop and search, they could intervene, they could search the person as well. If at that point they're dealing with the person and there's the mental health issues, there's various things that they can do, take them to the hospital, take them to a place of safety. But the initial way into it would be through adult protection powers.
Can I come back, convener?
Yes.
In terms of those adult protection powers, would they actually require consent to do that search?
No.
Okay, so instead of non-statutory stop and search, which we have, we would use other methods within the law for them to carry out a search where there was no consent?
Yes.
Okay.
That's fine. It is a difficult area.
It is,
want to come in?
Different issue.
Okay. No, I think it is. I think I don't see a straightforward solution to these. But I think what you've made me aware of, and perhaps I should have been aware, is there are lots of other statutory routes for it. And what you're telling us is the police aren't necessarily aware of the routes that they were, and that any code of practice or guidance would incorporate these issues, would incorporate, you can do this in these circumstances. Is that what I'm understanding?
The code of practice,
particularly in these difficult areas of children, vulnerable adults, you know, where if the police stood back, they'd be in the front, and something dreadful happened, they'd be in the front page of the papers.
Yes.
You know, so it's hard for the officers at that time. So we don't want to inhibit common sense, as it were, in working, and discretion, yes.
I think that would be a separate code of practice. The code of practice that we've suggested is for stop and search, but it may be that as a result of recommendation 10 and some of the discussions that at the very least there should be a protocol and how to, in particular, to deal with emergency situations where primary responsibility is given by statute to local authorities, but no officer of the local authority is likely to be confront, well, it's more likely, for example, to be a police officer or someone in healthcare that deals with it first. If it's a police officer, then they need to know that, that there's an adult protection path that takes them right away from the criminal justice side of it.
I think that dreadful case of the lady down the mineshaft, where we were so busy working out whose responsibilities were, that you know nobody took over and did something at the scene. Whether it would have resolved matters or not, I don't know. But you know, I think that's what we have to be careful. Yes, I'm good. You're the same issue. And then I'll take Alison John.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Scott, in the course of your inquiry, did you come across anything that substantially had changed in the way the world works in the last 3 years that had caused this, this particular movement to so-called non-consensual, non-statutory stop and search? Because the issue, for instance, that Mr. Stewart's highlighted is something that in 30 years as a police officer, of course you dealt with people in these circumstances. And the reason you dealt with them because your obligation as a public servant is to protect life and property.
Yes.
And it was never an issue of search. So that's... But there's nothing substantive that's changed.
There isn't anything, no. There's now specific statutory powers and duties, and they include the reference to protection of life.
Thank you.
Thank you for clarifying, Alison, something separate.
Yeah, and Elaine Murray touched on the issue of training, and I'll note that you didn't recommend that voluntary stop and search or non-statutory ceased forthwith, but that it ceased after the code of practice had been developed because you felt the need for a change and for training. I think it was quite disturbed to read in your report that you said that you talked about the worrying example whether to tell an individual in non-statutory stop and search that they could refuse to consent. Where Police Scotland training was pitched at what might be excused or tolerated by the courts rather than what was known to be good practice. So are you saying that there is a need for a cultural change within Police Scotland in relation to this issue?
Absolutely, there's a need for a cultural change and possibly a need for better legal advice than they got in that situation. I mean, the advice was strictly speaking correct if it said if you end up in court having failed to give someone the warning that they do not require to consent to a consensual search, the court will nonetheless, subject to other circumstances, excuse that and admit the evidence. But that is certainly not where you would pitch the training. And we had understood that the training was to the effect that everyone would be told, you can say no. Now, that might seem obvious to all of us, but I've certainly had clients over the years to whom that would not necessarily be obvious. And if a police officer asks any one of us something, depending on the circumstances, that might seem less like an open question to which a possible answer is no. The power imbalance is definitely there and is felt even by people that are able to deal with themselves, able to handle themselves better.
I'll be honest, I'd be reluctant to say no in case I was committing something else while I was busy doing it.
That's always the fear. So a cultural change is the biggest change required. There are officers who clearly, to some extent, may have felt that they need this. I heard evidence from younger operational officers who said, well, and seemed very genuine, don't take this away from me because I don't think I'm able to do things properly. Now, I think that they were wrong. And I've agreed to go back and meet with some of these officers and try and help as part of the process to explain it. But training is going to be a big part of it, but also the culture, because what I understand is that if it's training where they simply go online and they look at it themselves, that doesn't necessarily take hold in the same way. If you go to the police college, then that doesn't necessarily take hold in the same way, although I've been up at Tully Allen and seen some very, very impressive training there, inspirational training, in fact, there. But a lot of that then gets shaken out of them when the sergeant is speaking to them at the start of the shift. So it needs to get at all of those levels. One of the ways of doing it is to have officers seeing alternative ways of doing things in practice, so that they're confronted with real-life situations and they see colleagues who are more confident in the range of powers that they have without having to look at non-statutory, dealing with it comfortably, dealing with it well, dealing with it effectively. I've heard suggestions of anything from a year to 4 years as to how long it might take for that sort of transition to go all the way through. Obviously, it should be done absolutely as quickly as possible. But the other example we gave of a policy that was announced and then implemented within 5 days, it didn't work. There was real misunderstanding then about what the change was, with some officers thinking we can't search young people at all now, even on a statutory basis, and that was never the case. So it needs to go from top to bottom in the organisation, with every opportunity taken to say you can still do your job and you can still do it effectively. We can get the Federation, we can get ASPS involved in that. I've said that I'll become involved in any aspect of the training or trainer training if that helps, and hopefully legal advice that's given to them in the future will also say, but you don't need to pitch it at what you'll get away with in the court. You can pitch it higher, and if good practice on occasion, for whatever good faith reasons, isn't possible, then that can be explained and the courts will probably understand and accept that. But if you're aiming for that level, if you're aiming for the bottom, unfortunately, sometimes it's easier to go lower than that. Whereas if you're aiming for good or best practice and you drop below those standards, then hopefully you don't drop so far that it goes through the floor.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Right, can I say thank you very much, Mr. Scott, for your evidence, and that concludes the session today. It was extremely interesting. Thank you very much. Moving into private session.